Gravitation, Part 1. Introduction to Gravitation. In this video, we will get an introduction to gravitational force and centripetal force. In our galaxy, planets revolve around a sun in orbits. We also know that the moon goes around the earth. Remember Sir Isaac Newton, who formulated the well-known laws of motion. It is often said that in 1665, he came up with the idea of gravity when an apple fell on his head. Here are a few examples of objects attracted towards the earth. Rain always falls towards the earth. We observe that as soon as football rises above the field, it falls back on earth. An apple detaching from the branch of a tree falls to the ground. Therefore, we can conclude that rain, football, and apples are attracted to the earth. But do the objects also attract the earth? If yes, then why don't we see the earth moving towards the apple? It is because, according to the second law of motion, acceleration is inversely proportional to the mass of an object. The mass of an apple is negligible compared to the mass of the earth. Because of this reason, although they both attract each other with the same amount of force, the acceleration of the earth is much less compared to the acceleration of the apple. It is because of this same reason that we do not see the earth moving towards the moon. All the planets revolve around the sun, as a similar force exists between them. Newton concluded that all objects in the universe attract each other. This force by which all the objects tend to attract each other is the gravitational force. Gravitational force is responsible for the motion of the moon around the earth. Falling of objects on the surface of the earth and for motions of the planets around the sun. Now, let us try to understand centripetal force. Let us do one simple activity to understand it better. Take a piece of thread and tie a small stone at one end. Hold the other end and whirl in a horizontal circle. Note the motion of the stone. Release the thread, but only after ensuring that no one is around you. What do you think will happen when you release the thread? Now, let's understand what was happening. Before the thread is released, the stone revolves in a circular path with a certain speed. The stone changes direction at every point. The change in direction of stone occurs due to the change in its velocity or acceleration. The force which maintains this acceleration and keeps the stone moving in a circular path acts towards the center. This force that causes acceleration on a body moving in a circular path and is directed towards the center of rotation of the body is called the centripetal force. If there is no centripetal force, the stone will fly in a straight line, forming a tangent to the circular path of the stone. One of the examples of centripetal force is the motion of the moon around the earth. The moon orbits around the earth due to the centripetal force provided by the gravitational force of the earth. A lack of a centripetal force would put the moon in a uniform straight line motion. Bye-bye, moon! In this video, we got an introduction about gravitational force and centripetal force. In the next video, we will learn about the universal law of gravitation. ग्रेविटेशन पार्ट टू यूनिवर्सल लॉ ऑफ ग्रेविटेशन। इन द प्रीवियस वीडियो वी गॉट एन इंट्रोडक्शन अबाउट ग्रेविटेशनल फोर्स एंड सेंट्रिपेटल फोर्स। इन दिस वीडियो वी विल लर्न अबाउट द यूनिवर्सल लॉ ऑफ ग्रेविटेशन। Earlier, we learned how Isaac Newton discovered the laws of gravity. Let's now know a bit more about him. Sir Isaac Newton was born in Woolsthorpe, near Grantham, England. He was born in a poor farming family, but he was not very good at farming. In 1661, he was sent to study at Cambridge University. In 1665, it is said that an apple fell on his head, and this encouraged Newton to connect the force that kept the moon in its orbit with the force that made the apple fall. But even before Newton's time, scientists had always been interested in the motion of planets. By the 16th century, the scientists and astronomers had managed to collect a lot of data on the motion of planets. From the data, Johannes Kepler derived three laws which govern the motion of planets, but Kepler failed to give a theory to explain why the planets moved in the way they did. It was Newton who explained that the cause of planetary motion is due to the gravitational force that the sun exerts on them. Now, can you tell why the universal law of gravitation is universal in nature? It is because the law is applicable to all the bodies in the universe. Whether the bodies are big or small, whether terrestrial or celestial, the law applies to all. Now, let us understand what exactly is the universal law of gravitation. The universal law of gravitation states that the force between two objects in the universe is directly proportional to the product of their masses and inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. The force is directed along the line joining the center of two objects. Mathematically, it is written as F is equal to G multiplied by M multiplied by M upon D square. Now, let's see how we can derive the mathematical representation of universal law of gravitation. Let us consider two objects A and B with masses m and m respectively, and the distance between them is d. Let the force of attraction between A and B be F. According to the universal law of gravitation, the force between the objects is directly proportional to the product of their masses. So, mathematically we can write it as F directly proportional to M multiplied by M. Now, the force is inversely proportional to the square of the distance between the two objects, that is, F directly proportional to 1 upon d square. Combining these two equations, we get F is directly proportional to M multiplied by M upon D square. Or F is equal to G multiplied by M multiplied by M upon D square, where G is equal to constant of proportionality or universal gravitation constant. So here, we can sum up the universal law of gravitation as F is equal to G multiplied by M multiplied by M upon D square. Now, let's see the mathematical formulae for universal gravitation constant G. From this equation, we can get F multiplied by D square is equal to G multiplied by M multiplied by M, or G is equal to F multiplied by D square upon M multiplied by M. Can you determine the SI unit of G from the previous equation? We can find the SI unit of G by substituting the units of mass, force and distance in this equation. The SI unit of G is Newton meter square per kilogram square. The value of universal gravitation constant G was calculated by Henry Cavendish. He used a sensitive balance to do so. The accepted value of G is equal to 6.673 multiplied by 10 raised to minus 11 Newton meter square per kilogram square. After knowing about universal law of gravitation, can you calculate the force between you and your friend sitting nearby? Let's assume both of you have a mass of 50 kilograms each and the distance between you and your friend is 1 meter. You can pause this video to do the calculation. What did you conclude? Can you feel this force? If not, why? Newton's universal law of gravitation explained
some very important occurrences on Earth. It proved the existence of a force that binds all of us to the Earth. It proved how it is possible for the moon to be in motion around the Earth.
And also how it is possible for the planets to revolve around the sun. It also explained the phenomenon of tides, which occur due to the gravitational pull of the moon and the sun. So, that's a physics lesson fishermen need to remember. In this video, we learned about the universal law of gravitation. In the next video, we will learn about free fall. Gravitation, Part 3, Free Fall. In the previous video, we learned about the universal law of gravitation. In this video, we will learn about free fall. Almost everything that goes up falls down. Now, in this video, let us know more about free fall. Let's start by doing a simple experiment to understand free fall. Take a ball and throw it upwards. We see that the ball goes to a certain height and then it starts falling. Here, the Earth's gravitational force is attracting the ball and so it moves downwards. So, when an object falls towards the Earth due to the gravitational force, the object is said to be in free fall. When an object is in free fall, there is no change in its direction, but a change in the magnitude of velocity takes place due to gravity. And as we know, any change in velocity means acceleration. So, when an object is falling towards the Earth, an acceleration is involved. And the acceleration is due to the gravity of Earth. Thus, we refer to this acceleration as acceleration due to gravity. It is denoted by G. Its SI unit is the same as that of acceleration, which is meter per second square. Now, let us derive the formula for acceleration due to gravity. As we know from the second law of motion, force is equal to mass multiplied by acceleration. Let the mass of the ball in the previous activity be m, and as we learned, there is acceleration involved in a free falling object, which is denoted by g. So, the magnitude of the gravitational force F is equal to m multiplied by g. As we learned in previous video, F is equal to gm multiplied by m upon d square. Therefore, from the previous two equations, we can write m multiplied by g is equal to gm multiplied by m upon d square, or g is equal to g multiplied by m upon d square, where m is equal to mass of the earth, d is equal to
distance between the object and the center of the earth.
Let an object be near the surface of the earth. Then the distance d in the previous equation will be equal to r, the radius of the earth. Therefore, for objects near the earth's surface, g is equal to g multiplied by m upon r square. As you might know, the earth is not a perfect sphere. The radius of the earth increases from poles to the equator. Where do you think the value of acceleration due to gravity is more on earth? At the poles or at the equator? The value of acceleration due to gravity, g, is more at poles than at the equator. The value of g is more or less constant on the surface of the earth or near the earth's surface. But for objects far from the earth, we can calculate g using the formula g is equal to g multiplied by m upon d square. Now, let's see how we can calculate the value of g. To find out the value of g, we have to put the values of g, m and r in this equation. G is equal to g multiplied by m upon r square. Universal gravitational constant g is equal to 6.7 multiplied by 10 raised to minus 11 Newton meter square per kilogram square. Mass of the earth m is equal to 6 multiplied by 10 raised to 24 kilograms, and radius of the earth r is equal to 6.4 multiplied by 10 raised to 6 meters. We know g is equal to g multiplied by m upon r square. G is equal to 6.7 multiplied by 10 raised to minus 11 Newton meter square per kilogram square multiplied by 6 multiplied by 10 raised to 24 kilogram per 6.4 multiplied by 10 raised to 6 meters the whole square, which is equal to 9.8 meter per second square. Therefore, the acceleration due to gravity g is equal to 9.8 meter per second square. Now, let us perform one more activity to understand whether all objects, hollow or solid, small or big,
when allowed to fall from the same height, will fall with the same rate or not.
Take a sheet of paper and a small ball. Drop both the things at the same time from the first floor of a building. What do you think? Which object will reach the ground first? We notice that the ball reaches the ground first and then the paper. This happens due to the air resistance. Air resistance is because of the friction to the motion of the falling objects. Here, the air resistance offered to paper is more in comparison to the ball. However, if we perform this activity in a glass box from which all the air has been sucked out, the paper and the ball will fall at the same rate. In this video, we learned about free fall. In the next video, we will learn about mass and weight.
Gravitation, Part 4. Mass and Weight. In the previous video, we learned about free fall. In this video, we will learn about mass and weight. Mass and weight are often confused as the same thing, but they are absolutely not. Remember, we learned that the mass of an object is the measure of its inertia. And we also learned that greater mass offers greater inertia. Now, let's understand more about mass and how it is related to weight but is not the same as weight. Mass of an object remains the same everywhere. It doesn't matter whether the object is on the Earth, the Moon, or even in outer space. Therefore, we can say that the mass of an object remains constant and does not vary from place to place. We know from the previous video that the Earth attracts every object with a certain force. The weight of an object is this force with which it is attracted towards the Earth. This force is defined on the basis of the mass of the object and the acceleration acting due to gravity. As we have learned, force is equal to mass multiplied by acceleration. Here, the acceleration is the acceleration due to gravity. Therefore, we can say F is equal to M multiplied by G. Denoting the weight by W, we can write the previous equation as W is equal to M multiplied by G. Mass and weight are two different properties of an object, and that is why they have different units of measurement as well. As the weight of an object is the force with which it is attracted towards the Earth, its SI unit is the same as that of force, which is Newton. Whereas the SI unit of mass is kilogram. Weight is a force which acts vertically downwards. So, it has both magnitude and direction. Another important distinction is that the mass of an object remains the same everywhere. Whereas the weight of an object varies with the position of an object. Because acceleration due to gravity varies with position. Remember, we learned in the previous chapter that the value of acceleration due to gravity is more at poles than at the equator. Considering that, where do you think you will weigh more? At the North Pole or at the equator? Your weight will be more at the North Pole than at the equator. But keep in mind that the difference will be relatively small. Now, let's take another example. Let's see how the weight of an object varies on the Moon. How do you think the weight of an object will vary on the Moon? Will the object be heavier or lighter on the Moon compared to when it was on the Earth? Weight of an object on the Earth is the force with which the Earth attracts the object. Similarly, the weight of an object on the Moon is the force with which the Moon attracts the object. Now, let us find out what is the force on the Moon. Let the mass of an object be M and let its weight on the Moon be Wm. Let the mass of the Moon be Mm and its radius be Rm. We know that according to the universal law of gravitation, F is equal to G multiplied by M multiplied by M upon R square. Now, by applying the universal law of gravitation, the weight of an object on the Moon will be Wm is equal to G multiplied by Mm multiplied by M upon Rm the whole square. Let the weight of the same object on Earth be We. Let the mass of the Earth be M and its radius be R. Now, by combining two of the previous equations, G is equal to
g multiplied by m upon r square and w is equal to m multiplied by g, we get we is equal to gm multiplied by m upon r square. Have a look at this table, which gives us some information about the Earth and the Moon. Now, by substituting the values from the table in the previous equations, we get Wm is equal to 2.431 multiplied by 10 raised to 10 g multiplied by m. We is equal to 1.474 multiplied by 10 raised to 11 g multiplied by m. Now, dividing the previous equations, we get Wm upon We is equal to 2.431 multiplied by 10 raised to 10 upon 1.474 multiplied by 10 raised to 11, or Wm upon We is equal to 0.165, which is almost equal to 1 upon 6. Weight of an object on Moon upon weight of an object on Earth is equal to 1 upon 6. Weight of an object on Moon is equal to 1 upon 6 multiplied by its weight on the Earth. What will be your weight on the Moon? Now, let us solve a problem together. The weight of an object on the Moon is 50 Newton. How much will the object weigh on the Earth? Pause this video and make your calculations. Weight of an object on Moon upon weight of an object on Earth is equal to 1 upon 6. Weight of an object on Earth is equal to 6 multiplied by its weight on Moon, which is equal to 6 multiplied by 50 Newton, which is equal to 300 Newton. In this video, we learned about mass and weight. In the next video, we will learn about thrust and pressure. Gravitation, Part 5. Thrust and pressure. In the previous video, we learned about mass and weight. In this video, we will learn about thrust and pressure. Imagine you are standing in a desert and your feet go deep into the sand. Now, lie down on the sand and you will notice that your whole body does not go that deep into the sand. In both situations, the force exerted on the sand is your body weight. We have learned that weight is the force which acts vertically downwards. Therefore, here the force is acting perpendicular to the surface area of the sand. This force acting perpendicular to the surface area of an object is called thrust. SI unit of thrust is the same as that of force, that is Newton. But why did you start sinking in the sand while you were standing and not while you were lying down on it? To understand it better, let's look at another situation. Have you ever fixed a poster on a bulletin board with the help of drawing pins? You will have to apply force on the head of the drawing pin. The force on the drawing pin is perpendicular to the surface area of the bulletin board. This force acts on a smaller area on the tip of the drawing pin. Now, let's understand how the concept of thrust is related to pressure. Let's go to the desert example again. When you are standing and lying on the desert sand, When you are standing on the sand, the force is acting on an area equal to the area of your feet. Whereas, when you are lying on the sand, the force is acting on an area equal to the area of your body. The contact area is larger in the second case. Therefore, the effects of force of the same magnitude acting on different areas are different. Thrust is the same in both cases, but its effects are different. Thus, we can conclude that the effect of thrust relies on the area on which it acts. The effect of thrust is more when the area upon which it is acting is less. Thrust per unit area is called pressure. Pressure is equal to thrust upon area. Substituting the units of thrust and area in the previous equations, SI unit of pressure is Newton per meter square. To honor the scientist Blaise Pascal, the SI unit of pressure is termed as Pascal. It is denoted as PA. Now, let's understand how pressure acts on the fluids. Like solids, fluids also have weight. They exert pressure on the base and on the side walls of the container in which they are enclosed. Let us now see how this relates to our next topic of buoyancy. Why does a huge ship made from iron and steel float on water, while a small needle sinks in the water? Now, let us perform an activity to understand the role of buoyancy in these two instances. Take an empty plastic bottle with a closed lid and try to immerse it in a bucket of water. You will see that the bottle floats on the water surface. Try to push the bottle deep into the water, and you will experience the presence of an upward force. Push the bottle further till the bottom of the bucket and release it. You will notice that the bottle bounces back and floats on the water. Is gravitational force not acting on the bottle? Why does it keep bouncing back to the surface? Gravitational force is acting on the bottle in the downward direction, and the water exerts an upward force on the bottle. As a result, the bottle keeps floating. Therefore, we can conclude that the upward force of water is more than the gravitational force acting on the bottle. We have learned that the weight of an object is the gravitational force acting on the object. Thus, we can say the upward force exerted by the water on the bottle is more than its weight. This upward force is called buoyant force or upthrust, and this property is known as buoyancy. Now, let's do another activity to find out why a substance floats or sinks when placed on the water surface. Take a glass filled with water. Place a nail and a cork of equal mass on the surface of the water. You will notice that the nail sinks while the cork floats on the water. It is because of the difference in the densities of the substances. Density is defined as the mass per unit volume. Its unit is kilogram per meter cube. The cork floats as its density is less than that of water. It means the upthrust on cork is greater than the weight of the cork. While the nail sinks as its density is more than that of water. It means the upthrust on the nail is lesser than the weight of the nail. Have you heard about the Dead Sea? The water in that lake has the highest salt content. And so, it has such high density that even humans can float in it. But they need to make sure not to gulp its salty water. Let's perform a simple experiment to see what role density plays in floating and sinking of an object. Take two glasses filled with water. In the first glass, place a grape. In the second glass, add a few spoons of salt and then place a grape. You will notice that the grape sinks in the first glass while the grape floats in the second glass. In the first glass, the density of water is less than that of the grape, so it sinks. But in the second glass, the density of the water and salt solution is higher than that of grape, so it floats. Now, let us perform a simple activity to see what happens to the weight of a substance when immersed in the fluid. Take a piece of stone and tie it at the end of a spring balance with the help of a string. And note the reading in the spring balance. Then, immerse the stone in a glass of water. And again, take the reading in the spring balance. You will notice that there is a decrease in the reading, which means that there is a decrease in the weight of the stone. It is because there is an upward force acting on the stone. We know that this upward force is the buoyant force. But what is the magnitude of the buoyant force acting on any substance? The answer to this question was found by a Greek scientist named Archimedes. Archimedes found out the answer when he noticed that the water in a bathtub overflowed when he stepped into it. Archimedes shouted, "Eureka, Eureka!" meaning, "I have got it," as he ran through the streets. The Archimedes principle states that when a body is partially or fully immersed in the fluid, then an upward force acts on the body, which is equal to the weight of the fluid displaced by the body. Archimedes' principle is applied in various cases, like in designing ships and submarines, in lactometers to determine purity of milk, and in hydrometer to determine the density of liquids. We can find out if an object will sink or float in water by comparing its density with that of water. The ratio of the density of a substance to the density of water is known as its relative density. Relative density does not have a unit as it is the ratio of similar quantities. In this video, we learned about thrust and pressure.